I want to start to talk about the barriers out there that are actually preventing deaf people to going into medicine and STEM careers. And there's not one single reason, and it's not specific to women, but it all starts with language deprivation. 95% of deaf children are born to hearing parents, and it might be that they've never actually met a deaf person before, and so they're really dependent on advice from others. Medical professionals routinely advise parents against signing with their deaf child, with the aim of ensuring speech and language development. But deaf children are visual learners by nature, and the use of sign language ensures full access to language, no matter what, and safeguards that language acquisition period. Research has proven this. Denying a deaf child sign language is denying them full access to language, and language deprivation is a reason for the rise we're seeing in mental health issues in children. Difficulty communicating with family increases the risk of a mental health disorder by 4 times. This is avoidable. Baby sign classes have become a huge trend, and it's so sad to see them full of hearing babies, parents marvelling at the ease with which their pre-verbal child can communicate their needs. Deaf children need this the most, but are actively denied the opportunity. Current education system is also failing deaf children. Deafness alone is not a learning disability, but yet the educational attainment of deaf children is way behind their hearing peers. The UK statistics we have on science education is that only 60% of year one and year two children, which is between 5 and 7 years old, are reaching the expected standards in science, compared to 90% of their hearing counterparts. And the deaf pupils have performed worse than the previous year. The current education system is failing deaf children right from the very beginning. Deaf children are increasingly being integrated into mainstream education, many with no specialised teachers of the deaf, and deaf schools are being shut down. When they are teachers of the deaf, the UK government has mandated that they have level one competency in British Sign Language, BSL. At level one, you can communicate in simple words and phrases. You can have simple, everyday conversations in BSL. These are the people who are educating our future generation of deaf doctors and scientists. Is it any wonder that deaf children are underachieving? Once a deaf person has navigated their way to medical school, they are faced with even more hurdles. The UK standards of medical fitness to train mandates hearing and speech to be at a certain standard. This is phonocentric, archaic, and immediately deaf individuals who use sign language as their first language are set up to fail. The standards fail to acknowledge that there are many ways to overcome perceived or actual barriers. I use sign language interpreters and assistive technology at work. We need to move with the times. Even when sign language interpreters are present for students or employees, they nearly always have no scientific background. This impedes on the quality of the interpretation at the expense of the deaf person, leading to a slower learning curve. That's yet another struggle. In 1884, Alexander Graham Bell, inventor of the telephone, active figure in America's eugenics movement, wrote a journal article in which he described deaf people as dangerous, morose, ill-tempered, and sometimes looked upon as a sort of monstrosity to be stared at and avoided. Bell suggested ways of eradicating deaf people, including introducing a law banning genetically deaf people, like me, from marrying. Although we have come a long way since then, deaf people are still victims of prejudice, discrimination, and audism. There is still an ingrained and disconscious belief that deaf people are less able than their hearing counterparts, particularly those that use sign language. Many job applications are turned down, Many deaf individuals are constantly told what they cannot and shouldn't do. For those that turn to volunteer work instead, the government-funded Access to Work scheme won't cover the costs for interpreters. This should not still be happening. All said, deaf women in developing countries are even more disadvantaged. Many do not even receive an education, and access to language is severely limited. Let's not forget about them too. So what can we do to increase the amount of deaf people in medicine? Well, language deprivation is a huge problem, and this needs to be addressed first. Deaf children need to be given the best start in life and have full access to language, and learning sign language is one sure way to ensure that. Parents need to be told about this and get better provisions and support to enable them to make an informed decision on how they want to raise their deaf child. Sign language needs to be encouraged and celebrated, not repressed. Secondly, there needs to be more, not less, deaf schools, filled with high quality educators to remedy this education crisis. It needs to be recognised that mainstreaming deaf children isn't always the best option. As Dr. Rudolf Pinter once said, the aim of the education of the deaf child should be to make him a well-balanced, happy deaf person and not an imitation of a hearing one. There needs to be more sign language interpreters with experience in the field of STEM and medicine. There needs to be more focus on standards of sign language interpreting courses and the introduction of specialisations in medicine and STEM. By doing this, the sign language interpreter can understand scientific and medical jargon, improving the quality of the information being relayed and creating seamless access for the deaf individual in education and also in employment. The power of a deaf role model is not to be underestimated, and we need more of them. By putting role models at the forefront and creating deaf narratives, it means we are normalising deaf achievement and inspiring others to follow in their footsteps. Deaf children need to be told what they can do, not what they can't do, and have a sense of self-belief instilled within them. On a more general level, we need to switch our focus from the medical model of deafness to the social model. Many of us do not see ourselves as disabled, but are proud to be deaf and part of a culturally cohesive community, most barriers having been imposed by society. Therefore, ask yourself what simple adjustments you can also make so that we can start labelling deaf individuals as inspiration because of their achievements alone, and not because they achieve them in spite of the barriers put up by society. In the same vein, we need to change our line of questioning from, can they hear well? Can they speak well? Do they appear like a hearing person? To, are they well educated? Are they well adjusted? Are they comfortable with their deaf identity? Do they feel empowered? And are they happy? Once we can answer yes to those questions, we have created the right conditions for deaf achievement, and we can build up a larger community of deaf doctors and scientists that we can be proud of. I don't speak alone. What I say is the amalgamation of huge frustrations within the deaf community. There are so many deaf educators, deaf professionals, deaf children of hearing parents that are struggling against the current system and way of thinking. We need to remind ourselves that in amongst all the professionals out there that work with deaf children, deaf professionals are the true experts on deafness and are best placed to advise on issues relating to deaf education. Thank you for giving me the platform today to make our voices heard.